now move on with the afternoon program, and we are entering a next session, restoring the role of megafauna in European ecosystems. Well, the European bison is the best example, I would almost say, of present European megafauna. But before we continue with the program, I would like to welcome the new people that were possibly not able to attend the morning session, so they just joined in now. Of course, you missed a lot, but the good news is that you can later see this back on YouTube as we are recording the symposium, and we will be placing a link later through which you can watch what happened in this morning. Because people may be new, I would very briefly like to explain again the app that we are using. It's an app from Jelenj, which is a technical support company that's helping us out today. And they made an app through which you can interact in a certain way. You can namely ask questions. After presentations, we will have a question and answer session with the speakers. And during the presentation, you can post your questions in the app. So you go to the app, open it, and with the presentation that is coming up, you see that there's a question panel where you can start typing the questions that you have. Well, we have a very large attendance today with our symposium, so we will not be able to answer all the questions after the presentations. But we do collect questions so that after the symposium, we can make a list of frequently asked questions of things that that people come up with frequently, and we already see some pattern in there, and that we can later make a frequently asked question page in a newsletter and on the website, so that we can at least address some of them that we cannot attend today. What you also see in the app is there is a section called Poll, because we will also ask you questions. And with every presentation, we have a question that we ask, and then we have a number of options that you can choose and you can vote for which one you agree with. And we return after the presentations to the results of this poll. So we now will look at this megafauna restoration as the topic of our session. And in the case of the European bison, well, it's not necessarily easy to reintroduce European bison. We have just seen in our short movie also. But at least the bison still exist, so that makes it a bit more feasible. There's other species, like the aurochs, that went extinct. So then how do you go about restoring this type of megafauna? So in this, we will first watch a short video fragment that will be about an aurochs restoration project, so to say. It's the project Tauros, the Tauros program from the Tauros Foundation in the Netherlands. It's run by Ronald Goderi. He is a director of this Tauros Foundation. And he has a breeding program where he tries to breed back cattle, so in this case called the Tauros, that has traits of this extinct aurochs. And we will first look at this short video to see how he does it and what the purpose is of this project.
So Ron, tell me, what does the Tauros Foundation do?
Well, our main purpose is we've got a herd of cattle, horses, and we rent them out for renaturing areas in the Netherlands and elsewhere in Europe.
Yep. What's the unique part, though?
Yeah, our unique part
Tauros.
Is... Yeah, that's the Tauros yep. program. And, well, this idea we had in 2008, 2009. The idea was we needed a wilder type of cattle to do this job. Because, well, we had Scottish Highlanders, okay, they did a fairly good job, but if it's hot, they're in the water or in the shade. So a wilder type of cattle, also adapted to wilder circumstances, well, it was needed elsewhere in Europe, but also in the Netherlands.
So you looked to the Tauros, an animal which hasn't existed since 1627 in Poland.
Yeah.
Why was that the animal that you wanted to model this on?
Well, this was the real wild predecessor of all the cattle in the world. They were perfectly adapted to wild circumstances, with wolves, with bears, with lions, with tigers around. They were moving all over Europe and Asia. So if you need animals to do similar things, well, that would be the perfect model.
Yeah. And what do we need them for?
Yeah, we need them because everywhere in Europe, landscape is being abandoned. It's growing with brush and trees, and you want to keep this landscape partly open for biodiversity reasons. All kind of species, reptiles, amphibians, butterflies, they need these open spaces. And therefore you need large herds of grazing animals, as they used to be here before we humans had this big impact on Europe.
Okay, we'll just walk on.
I would like to start this session with a poll question. So that's a question for you. So just explained it, so please go to the app. So some people are voting already because they know how it works, of course. So take out your phone, open the app, look at the poll question that belongs with this session about megafauna and their role in European ecosystems. And the question that we have is about the video that you just saw. It's a Taurus program, is about the reintroduction of wild grazers into the abandoned farmlands of the European countryside. And should we do that or not? We gave four different options. We should not introduce backbred bovines into rewilding areas as they are not native. Or we should not introduce large grazers in rewilding areas, but only allow ecological processes without any form of intervention. We can introduce large grazers to fulfill the ecological role of the extinct aurochs, or introduce large grazers only when they enhance the biodiversity in rewilding areas. So we are curious to learn your opinion about that. So you can vote now and also during the presentation. And after the presentation, we will come back to this question and your opinions about it. Our next speaker will address the role of large animals in European ecosystems. So during his presentation, you can ask your questions in the app also. And we will select a number of those to answer after the presentation. And I would now like to introduce our speaker, and that is Professor Jens Christian Svenning. Jens is a professor in macroecology and biogeography at Aarhus University in Denmark, where he is also director of the Center for Biodiversity Dynamics in a Changing World. So these large wild animals, the megafauna, have largely disappeared from the European landscapes. And Jens will address what role as these animals have in ecosystems, and therefore what their return may mean for biodiversity restoration. Jens, welcome at the symposium.
And thank you very much.
I would like to invite you to please go ahead with your presentation.
Thank you very much, Lisbeth, for inviting me and for the kind introduction. Yes, so I'll speak on the potential for restoring the role of megafauna in European ecosystems. And of course, restoration and rewilding is about many other things than megafauna, but I would like to just briefly explain why I think megafauna really needs special attention. And of course, a starting point which should be clear from this morning also is that megafauna, large-bodied animals simply, are ecologically important. But another key point is that they have suffered very strong historical losses. And this actually has led to that we have often forgotten them, and we often misunderstand them and their role in ecosystems. And altogether, this also points to a need for active restoration because they've been pushed so far back in many places. At the same time, which is super important for restoration because restoration and rewilding will only matter if it can be applied to big areas, is that they have really high upscaling potential and they're relevant in Europe, basically in all ecosystems and all areas. And of course, also they have a very high cultural value. As a starting point for my talk, I'd like to highlight that the megafauna that we after all have in most of European landscapes that we're used to is highly unusual in the sense that it's unusually poor in a historical perspective. We actually have to go more than 30 million years back in time to find such a small downsized megafauna as currently is typical across Europe. And the reason for this is, very simply put, human impacts across the last at least 50,000 years. So conversely, you can also say that if we look historically, we see that rich megafaunas have really been the standout all across Europe in different climates, in different ecosystems, different landscape settings for millions of years. And what you see here on this image are some of the really large megafauna that has been very common, very widespread in Europe until a few thousand years back in time, the elk or moose, your bison, aurochs, and horse. And they have declined very strongly, of course, in the last few thousand years in response to rising human population densities. If we look further back in time, we see that really that functionally super diverse megafaunas have really been the norms, typical whether the climate was cold or warm, moist or dry, always very rich megafaunas for millions and millions of years, very consistently. And this is not just something that's of historical interest, because if we look at our current species, one of the things we have to realize is that our current existing species in our landscapes, they are super old. Most of the species we have around us, they are hundreds of thousands of years to millions of years old. And of course, the evolutionary adaptations didn't come out of nothing and are often even older. And just to highlight this, you can see here in the top photograph, a European beech, a species that has existed for several millions of years. And if you look below, you can see an American beech basically has the same ecological requirements and the same adaptations. It's a shade-giving, very competitive tree adapted to mild temperate climates. These traded about 10 million years ago. So this just tells you something about how old the adaptations to be a beech tree is. It's not something that has arisen to our cultural landscapes. It's a super ancient thing. One of the things that's important here is to think about what are the key ecological characteristics that have then allowed the long-term evolution and maintenance of our current biodiversity. And some of the key points are highlighted here is that over most of this time, there's been 100% area for nature. So space is super important. Also, these ecosystems, of course, have been wild and unmanaged. Our species are not adapted for management. And finally, one of the most consistent things about these historical wild ecosystems is that they've had abundant and diverse megafauna, really a typical thing. So if we look at megafauna from an ecological lens, see quite clearly that they promote biodiversity in natural landscapes. And you can see it illustrated, summed up in this graph. If you look to the left, you can see different functional guilds of megafauna, large and medium size, kind of large herbivores, mid-sized herbivores, and smaller herbivores. And the impacts that are indicated by the arrows, and body size is really a strong determinant of the impact. So the bigger, the more impact. Generate a range of processes, browsing, grazing, nutrient and seed dispersal, carbon pool diversification, that means generation of specialized biotic habitats such as bodies, living and dead, and dung, and they generate physical disturbances. All this enhance the landscape capacity for biodiversity via, on the one side, generating environmental heterogeneity, and on the other side, enhancing dispersal dynamics. In terms of environmental heterogeneity, that's actually one of the most important factors for enhancing landscape species richness. That's super well documented. And large herbivores are really key for generating a key facet of this, namely heterogeneity in the vegetation. In this figure here made by Lisbeth actually summarized this in terms of functional diversity on the horizontal dimension and density on the vertical dimension of large herbivores, how they impact in general the vegetation. And of course, in real landscapes, you have all these different constellations, meaning that you get very high functional or heterogeneity in the vegetation, something that we also have documented occurred in prehistoric times when we had these very rich functional megafaunas. And then again, also the megafauna then generates these biotic habitats and soil variation. At the same time, megafauna really enhances dispersal, and this is because body size is a key factor in the dispersal ability of species. And you can see it here on the graph. You have body size of animals, and then you have trophic levels indicated by the colors, but then you have the home range, so the typical area used by an animal, an individual. And you can see how it strongly scales with body mass. And this means that megafauna, not only themselves are very dispersive, but also disperse a lot of other species, for example, a lot of plants. And this is really important because dispersal is key for population persistence, for local species richness, and of course, something we need to consider very carefully these days for climate tracking. So this is sort of fundamental perspective on why megafauna is important. But also, as you already heard alluded to earlier today, there are real practical arguments for why we need to restore megafauna effects to European nature. A large proportion of European species depend on open and semi-open habitats, and these are widely threatened by tall-growing woody, tall-growing herbs and woody plants due to the absence of large herbivores. And this is something you can see documented on this graphic here, which is a big satellite-based analysis that my team has done, which covers semi-natural and natural areas across Europe. All the green areas are areas that have seen in the last years a densification of the vegetation. So you can see this densification is a super widespread problem. So for this reason, it's super important to re-establish megafauna broadly in European nature. And at the same time, of course, we actually have a large proportion of a large number of species that are specifically adapted to the special microhabitats that the megafauna constitute itself or generate themselves very specifically. We have many species adapted to dung, and not just any kind of dung, but dung from large animals, for example. And these species are highly pressured by the absence or low densities of large herbivores in our systems today, like this long-horned dung beetle here has really collapsed catastrophically in many parts of Europe. And if you look at this very impressive fly here to the right, this is a species that was thought extinct more than 150 years ago. It's a species that depends on carcasses from large ungulates and had not been seen for more than these 150 years until it was recently rediscovered in some small areas of Spain and France. But again, even if it has survived after all, it's strongly pressured by the lack of carcasses in European nature. So one of the things that we are struggling with because the loss of megafauna goes back so far back and is so pervasive is that we actually have a poor understanding of what are really natural densities of large herbivores, and this really affects how we also deal with them in our management. And we try to address this in this study that you see a summary figure from here, something that I did together with some close collaborators here in Denmark and elsewhere in Europe. So we collected data on large herbivore biomass from more or less natural areas around the world, and it's summarized here per continent. And for now, you can ignore the rewilding bar, but look at the other ones, and you can see Africa and Asia has high levels, at least sometimes, while the other areas generally have low levels, especially Europe and North America. This is very much a typical situation, and what this very much correlates to is that Africa and Asia, that's where the megafauna has survived the best. Why you see some areas that have low levels there is because you have these big problems around poaching, bushmeat hunting, and so on. If you then focus on the rewilding bar, that's densities from rewilding areas in Europe, and you can see that approach is what you see in Africa. And given that Africa is where megafauna is closest to, you can say, the natural levels, we interpret this as an indicator of what are really natural levels for megafauna and ecosystems. And here we are talking about something at least 100 kilos per hectare, up to 300 kilos, perhaps more. So that's at least one big animal per 100 meters. We also estimated that this general loss of megafauna, large herbivores in particular, around the world from natural ecosystems have caused a strong reduction in plant biomass consumption relative to what has been like the long-term natural conditions. So, which of course then again speaks into the importance of restoring their role in the ecosystems. This also points to another misconception around large herbivores, and this is what I would call the myth of predation control. There's a strong story, you can say, that many people believe in, also scientists, that large predators, they control large herbivores down to so small levels that they don't damage trees and really strongly affect the vegetation. And that's not true. If we look at what we know about recently intact megafaunas, what we see is that large carnivores, they overall large herbivore biomass. And you can see this nicely illustrated in this figure here from Yellowstone, where you have the famous wolf introduction. And then you can see the orange graph illustrate what happened with the elk, the American elk, which is the American red deer, after the wolf reintroduction, where it really was reduced to low levels. The y-axis here is an indicator of forage pressure from the population, so how much the intake of plants they need. So this story has complexities, but it holds up to some extent. But what is often ignored is that at the same time, the bison has really exploded. So basically now we have same pressure, herbivory pressure posed by bison on the ecosystem as before by elk, except that, and it would grow even higher, except that bison are being culled very severely in Yellowstone every year. And this is of course natural in the sense that now we have really an intact ecosystem there with wolves, bears and so on, but control the bison. And this is something we see in these kind of more intact systems. That doesn't mean that predation is not important. It still affects this balance between the large herbivore species, promoting the bigger species actually, and then also affects the spatial patterns of herbivory in terms of what's called the landscape of fear. This here is an image from Yellowstone that I took a while back. And what you see is this beautiful savanna landscape. This is the part of Yellowstone where you have many, many wolves. You also have many grizzly bears. You have cougars. And what you see in the middle is an herbivore exclosure. So there's a small fenced area, and you can see this landscape would be dense forest in the absence of the impacts of the bison in particular. So even when you have all these large carnivores around. So the megafauna has this strong upscaling potential I mentioned, and this is from the fundamental biology that species have capability of exponential population growth if the conditions are right. And we have seen that over and over again with bison, with elephants and so on, when they are allowed to basically by reduced hunting pressure and so on. But at the same time, reintroductions are strongly needed, first of all, because current landscapes are super fragmented, but also because many of these species have been pushed so far back into small refugial sources that it would take centuries or more for them to really come back on the big scales that they are needed. And of course, recovery is urgent. The biodiversity crisis is here, and the climate crisis is also something that we are facing quite urgently. I would like to also point attention to some of the really key large herbivore species that basically should be considered for rewilding pretty much everywhere in Europe, except the very high north, perhaps, and some other deviant environmental conditions. And these are the ox, the horse, and the European bison or bison. These species and their immediate ancestors, which had basically the same ecology, have been super common and widespread in Europe for more than 500,000 years. They've been consistently there continuously until human-induced declines in the last few millennia and centuries. So really been a constant members of European ecosystems very broadly. And some of the misconceptions around these species is that the aurochs as a species is extinct. That's of course not true. It survives very well in our livestock and feral cattle. So what's really missing is to restore it big time, you can say, as a wild species, because the species is still with us. And the same applies, of course, to horses. And horses are often portrayed as really step specialists. But if we look both on their current ecology, but also on their ecological history, that's clearly not the case. Horses have been super common in Europe, whether the climate was warm and moist or cold and dry, and been super flexible in diet and so on. So that's a strong misconception. Likewise, bison have often been misconceived as a dense forest specialist, and they actually don't like that at all. They're mosaic landscape adapted, like mixtures of woody plants and grassy areas. But again, they also have this super long constant presence in European history. Yeah, and I just put this image of different wild horses down below to illustrate that both ancient genetics and ancient cave paintings point out that horses didn't have just one morphotype, the original wild horses in Europe, but a huge variety. I would also like to highlight that megafauna are really not local species. They are continental or intercontinental species, and they have super dynamic ranges, in part because they are so dispersive. So this really highlights that to discuss native status for megafauna on really a local scale or national scale for most of the species, it doesn't make any sense if you look at this historical ecological perspective. And this also points to a strong argument for having a nuanced view on non-native megafauna, because we see over these time frames that our species have existed. There's been lots of natural colonizations of Europe, or repeated colonizations and recolonizations. And some of the non-natives that we have in our European landscapes now are being used in, for example, rewilding projects such as the water buffalo from Asia. They are analogs for recently extinct species, such as the very recently extinct European water buffalo, which has its latest occurrence, about 13,000 years ago. And I would argue here that the key is not where the species are coming from, but their function. So rewilding is about, a key aspect of rewilding is about reducing human control. But nevertheless, as you heard in pretty much all the talks today, people are truly central to rewilding. And that's because, of course, that we have many millions of people in Europe and we have billions of people on the planet, and we are gonna have even more in the near future. So one of the key aspects here is that for rewilding to really be something that matters, that really makes a difference for the biodiversity crisis and for the climate crisis as well, we need to make space for nature and for rewilding. One of the big societal dynamics that are helping us in this regard is actually the rural to urban migration, which has negative sides, but it also helps free space for nature. At the same time, we need to enhance farming yields even more, of course, sustainably. We need to shift to more plant-based diets, and we need to shift to more sustainable, diversified agricultural systems. They are key. There are quantitative analysis that show that these such shifts will really be able to allow much more space for nature. Of course, since we don't have empty landscapes anywhere on the planet, all implementation has to be done in democratic and fair manners, but also to ensure long-term support. And here it's key to really carefully analyze socio-ecological constraints, but also potentials to be able to realize this successfully. And one of the things I would strongly argue for here is that ongoing monitoring is very important, so that you can do adaptive management. If something happens, you can adapt. You can, if there are challenges, you can find ways around them. That's super important. And of course, there will be challenges, and coexistence with large wild animals is challenging. But I just want to highlight that when we discuss this in Europe, we have to realize that the European case is not more difficult than many other places on the planet. If you look at this picture here, it shows estimated human population density around the world. And you can look at India or East Africa with their amazing remnant megafaunas, and you can think about, yes, they don't have a more easy situation than we have for megafauna coexistence. Another thing that we can quite often forget a little bit in our discussions around restoration and conservation is climate change. But we are really looking into a future of very strong climate change, and therefore there's strong need to enhance climate resilience. We talk about warming of 1-2, well, not 1 or 2 degrees anymore, but more 3 to 4 to 5 degrees, but it can be hard to really realize what that means. So therefore, I'll show you this graphic here. You have the timeline below, and then you have the proportion of land area on the planet that will shift major climate type. That means like from tundra to boreal forest or temperate zone to subtropical zone. And then you have two climate scenarios. Basically, the red line is something that's more or less consistent with the Paris Agreement. And then the blue line is fossil fuel business as usual scenario. That's the line we are on so far. And you can see between these two scenarios, between 30 and 50% of the land area in year 2100 will have shifted major climate zones. So that will put major pressure on society, but also on biodiversity. And I really see rewilding as a major part of the solution to this global environmental emergency, with the key components of restoring large areas, really large areas, to nature, and restoring megafauna functions areas to enhance environmental heterogeneity and dispersal, to enhance the landscape capacity on the one side for biodiversity, but also because these two factors will also promote resilience to climate change. And of course, the good news in this is also that such large-scale rewilding also has a positive role to play in reducing climate change, in what's called climate mitigation, because natural ecosystems sequester much more carbon than areas under intense use. And by promoting resilience in these ecosystems, megafauna then also helps make this a resilient long-term benefit. And with that, I just want to thank very sincerely my many collaborators and the funders that make my research possible. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Jens. That was a very nice, very broad overview, both going back in time, in the time that we had a whole community of large megafauna, as well as the width of the perspectives that come for the future. So, of course, people have listened carefully to what you said and have posted quite a number of questions, of which we will now select a few. And the first one immediately goes about the past. The question is, how could you compare the impact of megafauna in the last interglacial period before the Holocene in the effects that megafauna could have now? And the sort of sub-question with that is, how can you measure the realism of the system that you're trying to recreate with rewilding? And I think this is something, this will be a frequently asked question, and I'm sure you have heard this before, so you have an answer to it.
Yes, well, I can try. Well, first of all, I would say, I mean, specifically rewilding, it's not really about recreation, it's past ecosystems, but we can learn from the past in terms of what's possible in terms of biodiversity potential and how does natural systems work and what kind of factors are really important in them. So I think that's the key things we can learn from the past. If we look to the past, the interglacial, I think it's we can learn a lot for managing current and restoring current ecosystems, because most of the flora and fauna is exactly the same as we have now, basically the same plant species, basically the same insects, very much the same small mammal species, but there's then this very rich functional megafauna. And so in this context, the last interglacial is a good lens for thinking about what could be possible in large natural areas if you restore a functional megafauna. It doesn't have to be identical to what was in the last interglacial, but a functional megafauna with diversity, functional diversity of large herbivores and also quite high densities.
Yeah, so in that respect, would you think that also you showed this example of this amazing fly species that was thought to be extinct but returned? Is it also that there are still sort of partners of these megafauna that may be extinct themselves, but we still have proxies, and in that way this contributes to biodiversity?
Yes, and we are lucky in Eurasia compared to, for example, the Americas, because in Eurasia the megafauna extinction has been more gradual, and it's actually been sort of replaced by domestic livestock a little pretty continuously. So we've never had a long period without quite large numbers of some kind of megafauna in the landscapes. Throughout Europe, at least, there's been parts where it's been reduced very strongly for some millennia, but throughout Europe, we've never really had these long periods without a significant megafauna. Only well in the last few centuries, or the last century, where we even have removed the livestock from the landscape. That's really new. So in that sense, the long period with pastoralism and extensive agriculture with livestock has sort of helped bridge the loss of the wild megafauna and the current situation, so that extinctions have not been so severe as in, for example, South America, where the big dung beetles, at least some of them, really just went extinct.
So we have a new question. How much time do we need to see these results of landscape diversity with grazers? Are we talking 50 years or hundreds of years?
Oh, I think it happens much more quickly than that. Of course, you have to have the herbivores restored to, you can say, ecologically meaningful densities. So in big landscapes, it will take some more time, but you can see, for example, from some very interesting African systems like the Gorongosa National Park, that it took maybe 10, 15 years to really restore a functional level of large herbivores, for example. So if you ensure that the species are in the system and you remove the pressures, then they can grow quite quickly because of this, the potential for more or less exponential population growth in smaller areas. I mean, you can see strong effects after a few years even.
Yeah, that's my experience as well, particularly in fertile soil, of course. So there's an interesting, I think, a very timely question. It's about these large open areas that you were talking about also that get increasingly endangered, the open spaces in Europe. And if large open areas are important for biodiversity, then is this idea in tension with the widespread narrative of replanting trees, which we, of course, do a lot now also for climate mitigation purposes?
Yeah, I mean, if you ask me if it's a good idea with this widespread planting of trees, I'm pretty skeptical about it. It's not to say that it's always a bad thing, but in many situations, first of all, it's not really needed. If you have, in many parts of Europe, after all, you have seed sources close by, and especially if it's fertile soil, like I have here in my garden, and just get lots and lots of trees coming up spontaneously. So it would be waste of time to some extent, unless you have very specific ideas about what tree species you want. So of course, you can also in reality do mixed kind of models where you plant some trees to help some of the ones that are slower in colonizing, or species that have been pressured far away, species that have been lost from large landscapes and so on. But this general just planting trees as a restoration approach, I would argue against, because that really endangers the species adapted for semi-open and open areas. And I would say overall, one should have a more, I would dare say, intelligent strategy to how we go about reforestation so that it really benefits biodiversity.
Yeah, in that way, that also refers to the rewilding concept. I guess that planting trees is not necessarily following a very strong rewilding perspective on nature restoration. We go back to the past. That fascinates people and you yourself also, I know. When you're talking about megafauna and the extinct animals, how far back in time are you willing to go until a species is no longer seen as native? And then the comment is that referring to elephants and cheetahs that were once native in Eurasia, but are now in Europe considered as non-native by most people. Where would you draw the line and why?
Well, I would say, it's hard to give a short answer, because in reality, the difference between native and non-native is not so black and white as we often talk about it. I mean, we often discuss it with respect to countries, but countries are political, cultural constructs. And I mean, from a biodiversity perspective, they are meaningless. So that's really irrelevant. And one of the things you have to think about is, of course, that all our species now in Northern Europe, for example, except for some of the Arctic species, they were in Southern Europe or South Central Europe or Southern parts of Eastern Europe 15,000 years ago and have existed for long times there, you can say, and further back in time were up here again and so on. Species have shifted forth and back across the European landscape. So I think to talk about non-native, you really have to consider species that come from totally different biogeographic regions as a generalization. There's complexities to this, but as a generalization. So, and for megafauna, since they're so dispersive, I would definitely say you have to be really non-native as megafauna. You have to look beyond Western Eurasia, because everything that's in Western Eurasia is within reach of Europe within a few individual lifetimes, for example.
Yeah, so in that way, it may also refer a bit to the shifting baseline syndrome. Usually we use that in a what shorter term context. But from a biogeography perspective, and you go back in time, in that way you could say maybe we are not used to these animals anymore. But if you go back long enough with relatively similar climate conditions, you would say you could still find these animals if humans had not limited their numbers or even driven them to extinction.
Yes, and just to follow on that, I mean, one of the interesting things to see is, for example, that from like 5,000-6,000 years ago until basically 2,000 years ago, we actually had lions recolonized in Europe after an earlier extinction of a sister species. So they came back in and they were widely occurring up to Hungary and Romania. And all of this time frame just disappeared actually within less than 2,000 years from now, due to the rising pressure from human populations. And of course, if this hadn't happened, they would have spread even further because they are very generalistic species. And in the same time, we actually had, in the Bronze Age, we had Asian elephants colonizing as far as Turkey before they started getting pushed the other direction, you can say. So these dynamics of what's native and not native to Europe is a bit of a tricky issue, and I would really argue for this longer term perspective and then focus on the function and of course on what's possible also in the real world rather than arguing around whether it's native.
So we will have a last question in this round. Within rewilding and conservation, there's a lot of focus on megafauna. Well, we ask you to speak about megafauna, so that makes sense in this case. But would you generally say that there is a disproportionate attention to megafauna, which may be overshadowing less charismatic organisms such as plants and arthropods?
Actually not. So to disclose a little thing here, I can say to this small audience that I'm really a botanist. I love plants, and if I go in places that are megafauna rich, I'll confuse people because I'll stop and look at a tree or an herb, and then people stop and what's he looking at? So I really appreciate plants a lot, and also insects for that matter. But I know more about plants. I think the focus on megafauna is actually not disproportionate because they have been particularly hard pushed back, and we have particularly forgotten about their role in our ecosystem. If you look to nature management in Denmark and across Western Europe and the rest of Europe, a lot of the management is centered around plants and whether an area is in good conservation status or not is judged from the plants. So plants really play a central role in the real world actual management. So they are not forgotten at all in that sense. You can say maybe a bit in the public eye, but not in the real management, where you can say it's actually more the megafauna that needs to get a more central place there. And for insects, I think they get attention to some extent in the public eye, but of course they are not understood well enough, so that people think they save bees by having domestic honeybees, which of course is rather a threat to all the wild bees than saving the wild bees and so on. There are many complexities to this. Well, yep. I think again the key point is that the megafauna has been pushed back very hard, and we still have many misunderstandings and a tendency to forget.
I would definitely agree with that. Even adding, like you showed in your presentation also, that the fate of some of plant species and arthropods may actually also be intertwined with the fate of the megafauna itself, of course. So we have many more questions of the audience, but we have to leave them for now. And I want to return to the poll and to see what people were saying about the question that we posed. And that was about the Taurus program and whether we should reintroduce or try to back breed animals that come close to aurochs. Well, there's two of the statements were easily the best voted for, almost 50-50, I would say. So again, we may be a little bit biased with our audience today, but generally people think it's a good idea to, or they, at least they agree with introducing large grazers, either to fulfill their ecological role of the extinct aurochs. The other half says it is a good idea, but only when they enhance the biodiversity in the rewilding area. So what is your take on that, Jens?
Well, I think my take is that we actually miss more attention to this species, the European or Eurasian wild ox, you can say. We have a species here which has basically gone extinct in the wild, but is still with us. For other species that this has happened to, we would have big conservation programs to restore them in the wild. So just for its own sake, I think European wild ox really deserves a program to restore it as a wild species in nature, because it's not extinct, it's still with us, but it really needs to be restored in wild nature so it gets under natural selection again, which is super important for maintaining it and its genetic diversity in the long term. And I think that something like the Towers program is a wonderful program to help this process, but we really need to have very high ambitions here, in my opinion, to get this species re-established very broadly in Europe as a wild species and under natural selection again.
So you would say to take it one step further with Tauros than even more than we are currently doing in different rewilding projects? So people have now, in the poll, there were some people that voted for the other options, actually. And that was not to introduce backbred bovines into rewilding areas, either because they are not native. Well, I think we just had some discussion about that. It depends on what you call native. And also, it depends how you look at these animals in case they still have the DNA, so to speak, of the aurochs, which as an animal went extinct, but still some of its DNA is preserved. And there were also some people that said we should not introduce large grazers in rewilding areas, but only allow natural ecological processes without any intervention. And in that way, you would call the reintroduction of these large grazers an intervention process. But this was a far minority. And I see Jens returned from his woods to be with us. That's great, because I had actually still a few questions for you. And the first is, you clearly take this long-term perspective by looking at historical and paleoecology. And the past presence of these animals is generally exciting. I think most people will agree with that. But given that some of these are extinct and other have very low densities, as you have already said also, how can we use the knowledge of the past really to inform the present and future nature management as we do it now?
Well, I think this historical perspective is actually super important. First of all, I think it can help us avoid what's called the shifting baseline, that we are satisfied with an already degraded situation. So looking to the past can help us see what's really possible in terms of biodiversity. So for me, that's one of the most important things. The other thing we can learn from the past is more about what processes are really important. And then you can say it can also help us understand better our species, because when we see the species today, many of them have really gotten very limited distributions and limited ecologies because of pressures from society over time, you can say. So looking to the past can help us better understand them. This is true for some of the megafauna species like bison or horse, but also for smaller species, some of the dung beetles, some of the plants, and so on.
Yeah, so in that way, with the shifting baselines and also the example that you showed from the European bison study, we all know bison in a way as an animal. But from the ecology side, some of our native megafauna, it seems we know very little about it. Would you agree with that?
Yes, totally. I'm taking an example like the European elk, which people would think about as a high northern species, a Scandinavian or Russian species. But actually, if you look to the history, you can see that elk still were still in the Netherlands until just 1,000 years ago, and down to southern Germany a few thousand years earlier, when the climate was at least as warm as now. So looking to the past there can really make us see that a species like that in a different light, that it has bigger potential than what we would see currently.
Yeah, so we talked earlier with Nestor also about connectivity and how species disperse. So in the European elk has a lot of people getting very excited about it. So also here in the Netherlands, for instance, we have a lot of wetlands where elk would probably be very happy. And then, of course, we can bring them here, but yeah, elk would be excellent dispersers too, I think. For these type of species, would you argue we could start reintroduction projects, or would you say, well, maybe we should be patient and try to not hunt them too much, so to give them a chance to walk all the way to the Netherlands, so to speak, or to Denmark, to spread further in Denmark?
Well, to be honest, I think time is not for patience, in my opinion. We are facing the biodiversity crisis now. It's not an academic exercise. It's there now. And we are at the same for the climate crisis, you can say. I mean, just look a few decades into the future. The forecasts are not very nice. So I don't think time is for patience. I think we have to restore as much as we can, as quickly as we can. So I'm not for saying that, okay, we wait and see, maybe the species will come back on its own in 50 years or 200 years. I think time is not for that.
So we should trick them in real soon, so to speak.
I think so. We have one restoration project for with the elk in Denmark for some years now, in terms of restoring the biggest northern European lowland peat bog, and so far that has been very successful, and I would highly recommend it.
Okay, and also for elk, do you observe impacts there on the local environment?
I mean, it's something that we're actually studying as we speak, you can say. But we can definitely see strong impacts in terms of browsing on woody plains, which was also, you can say, the functional purpose of restoring the species to the system. And it's doing what you expect. It's a browser. It's, you can say, the northern giraffe, and that's what it's doing.
And then the very last question in the spirit of the theme of the symposium today. How do you feel that rewilding practice can inform your work as a scientist?
I think it's super important, and I see several ways it can inform me as a scientist. First of all, even though I see very much power in looking to the past and also in large-scale geographical analysis, we also do need experiments in science. And something like rewilding is very hard to do as small-scale experiments, and it's very hard, you would say, for scientific projects to get the funding to restore populations of megafauna species, or I would say impossible. So there you can say rewilding projects work as real-world experiments, and especially if they have good monitoring programs connected to them, or if scientists can get involved with some of the sort of design, so there can be like unfenced, there can be fenced off parts, exclosures, stuff like that we can learn from. So that is one side of it. The other is that I think from rewilding practice, we can also learn about what questions to ask. So I'm always very curious to hear from the people working with the practical projects, what do they feel they don't know, or what would they like to know better, or have they experienced any surprises? Because it's not like we know everything about megafauna or ecology in general, for sure not. So in that sense, it's also super inspiring and important to have the dialogue.
Yeah, I cannot agree more with that. So herewith, I would like to thank you very much for your contribution, Jens. It was a fantastic overview of the megafauna and the role they played in the past, present and future. And we will now continue with the next session. So thank you.